As well as the things we carry deep in our heart, send your presence and healing mercies. And God of peace and justice, guide us to bring your kingdom here to earth. Guardian of our souls, for those who live in fear for tomorrow, for those who have lost loved ones, for those who are seeking shelter, we pray that your spirit of comfort would draw near. May we all find our hope and help in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us now turn our hearts to worship.
Join me in the call to worship. Sisters and brothers, let us gather together with glad and generous hearts.
For many signs and wonders are being done among us.
Let us break bread together and share our lives in common.
Let us give what we can to all who have needs, so that all people, no matter who they are, may regard us with goodwill.
Love changes everything.
have a Bible?
Because God knew I couldn't remember everything he wanted to tell me.
So God knew that she could remember everything that he would tell her.
And the story of God's love.
Story of God's love.
A guide.
A guide. A guide for our life. Like I mentioned last week at the end of our service, we have questions. When, where, why, how? The Bible, with its history and poems, songs and wisdom teachings, can answer many of our questions. But the most important Bible answers the question of who. Who created the world? Who created us? When I was a kid, I had lots of questions. I wanted to know more than just the Bible stories or simply how to get to heaven. Most specifically, I wanted to know how we were to live while we were here on the earth. It hit me one day in college as I was reading the Old Testament book of Micah that we are told how to live and be in the world. Micah 6:8 says, "He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with him." This verse changed how I read the Bible. It also helped me to see that Jesus also gives us instructions of how to live and be in the world. Most importantly, he told us in Matthew 22, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." But before we can follow Jesus' commandments, we first have to realize that God loves us. Once we realize God's love for us, then we are able to receive his gifts of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, forgiveness, and belonging. And once we receive these gifts, then we are more able to share these gifts with those we meet. Repeat after me this prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for the gifts.
Thank you for the gifts.
You give to us.
You give to us.
Help us to share.
Help us to share.
Your love and gifts.
Your love and gifts.
With everyone we meet. Amen.
We stand as we sing hymn number 128, "He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Fount."
Thank you.
begin our prayer for illumination. Loving God, we pray
that your Holy Spirit will strengthen us to be devoted to the teachings of your word, that through it we may hear your voice and follow it into eternal life. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing hymn number 400, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Reality of suffering as part of our Christian faith, and how we are to suffer. Usually I read from the NRSV, but today I'm going to read from the Message Bible. Our scripture reading comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 25. You who are servants, be good servants to your masters, not just to good masters, but also to bad ones. What counts is that you put up with it for God's sake when you're treated badly for no good reason. There's no particular virtue in accepting punishment that you well deserve. But if instead you're treated badly for good behavior and continue in spite of it, be a good servant, that is what counts for God. This is the kind of life you've been invited into, the kind of life Christ lived. He suffered everything that came his way so you would know that it could be done, and also know how to do it step by step. He never did one thing wrong, not once said anything amiss. They called him every name in the book, and he said nothing back. He suffered in silence, content to let God set things right. He used his servant body to carry our sins to the cross so that we could be rid of sin, free to live the right way. His wounds became your healing. You were lost sheep with no idea who you were or where you were going. Now you're named and kept for good by the shepherd of your souls. May God bless the reading and the hearing of our scripture. From New Testament times to present day, believers have chosen to put themselves in harm's way to be faithful to their understanding of God's claim on their lives. Corrie ten Boom and her family hid Jews from the Nazis in the Netherlands during the early 1940s. Unfortunately, when their efforts were discovered, Corrie and her family were imprisoned, and some died. She survived to tell the story of standing up for what was right in the face of evil. Corrie described how her faith gave her courage not only to survive the horrors of Holocaust, but also to reach a place of peace. With time, God even enabled Corrie to forgive those who had wronged her. In the 1950s and 1960s in America, bitter cultural divides were exposed and gave rise to an equally powerful witness over issues of race. Peter's words in verse 23, when Christ was abused, he did not return abuse, inspired Martin Luther King Jr., a leader of the movement. Christ's example in advocating nonviolent resistance came to shape the civil rights movement. As a disciple of Christ, Peter witnessed Jesus' example of not returning abuse. But before he was a follower of Jesus, he was a fisherman. Fishermen's exposure to all kinds of weather made them hardy and fearless. They were accustomed to bearing with patience many trying circumstances. I think it is this strength and determination Jesus saw in Peter is why he claimed Peter as the rock on which he would build his church. What always amazes me is that Jesus made this claim about Peter, knowing that one day Peter would deny knowing him at his trial. But Jesus knew Peter's potential. He knew that he would come out of this on the other side, even stronger. In today's reading, we get a glimpse of what Christ saw in Peter. Through the lens of his own experiences, Peter is attempting to provide a word of comfort and hope to suffering people who felt crushed by their circumstances. distinguishes between suffering for a just cause and suffering for an unjust cause. Nowhere does these verses suggest that suffering is a legitimate condition for those who are abused, coerced, or oppressed. Nowhere does it imply a stoic tolerance for violence against anyone. These verses suggest a preference for an alternative ethic, an alternative to the pagan culture these fledgling Christians are part of, and an alternative to their own traditions. To hold fire when under attack is a radical choice that seems humanly impossible. Yet Jesus Christ modeled it. The abuse Christ received did not produce abuse. His suffering did not produce more suffering. Hurt was not the knee-jerk response to being hurt. Peter is reminding these Christians and us that trusting God in the midst of suffering is considered the high calling to which we should aspire. Under any condition, this would be a hard lesson, but it must have been brutal for the enslaved people. To help us apply this scripture to our circumstances today, consider how most of the world we know is measured in bits and binary compounds. In this system, you choose one or zero. You choose one or zero over and over again in countless combinations. This is the basic premise of our digital world. The one, zero choice rules our airwaves, computer screens, cell phones, and almost every decision. Embedded even in our smallest news, this theory drives our days without giving it much thought. It informs us at a deep level what we think is possible and what we believe is not. Limited choices lead us to fall back impulsively to right, wrong, either or, yes, no, flight or fight actions. The evidence of binary thinking can be seen across the spectrum of life. One gang member's slight becomes another's death warrant on the streets. In the boardroom, one failed contract becomes the automatic justification for downsizing. In the schoolroom, one quirky learner becomes labeled a problem. In the family, one disappointment in a relationship becomes the foundation for divorce. In the church, one year of decline means the church is dead. Generally, we work under the limitation of this mindset all the time. In our text for today, however, is the subtle message that there are always more than two choices. I think that is something we have forgotten. One can be abused and not become a serial abuser. One can suffer ridicule or physical harm and avoid a cycle of never-ending violent behavior. Jesus' experience on the cross teaches us that God always has life-giving options that expound possibilities and trigger instincts only God can touch. This kind of possibility is what we are praying for in our breakthrough prayer. We are praying for life-giving options to unleash new life and open doors of dreams, hopes, and possibilities for us here at Green Meadow. When we are in the midst of difficult times, we can think we are trapped without any options. Fear can blind us to seeing things being different. Through Peter's writing is the suggestion to struggling Christians that their world may not be as restricted and constrained as they think. cure for all the ways life is frightening and dangerous, God offers a third way. It is an expansive way. In unity with the letter's first listeners, we understand what it means to be boxed in or even enslaved. We know what it feels like to have limitations. While we are not in the situation of first century slaves, there is plenty that makes us feel less than free. Our enslavement today may be to a mindset strangled by binary thinking. Fears and dangers in our world enslave and limit our creativity for solutions. Anxieties about health and worth and the next paycheck can enslave our instincts for hope in the future. There is something we can learn from these early believers about trust amid our own suffering. Today, we can find ourselves against the wall of a culture that could not care less about an alternative ethic or trusting God. The prevailing ethics is self-centered at its root and considers the other only as an item on the tax return. Trust is defined as the safest place to store money. Hemmed in all sides, we are spiritually claustrophobic and caught in the limits we have set for ourselves. The antidote we need will burst open the tombs that hold us captive and liberate us for God's expansive way. We will emerge from these tombs unbound for a life that can mean something. We all have personal and corporate wounds that need to be healed. Places where brokenness threatens our existence as individuals and as communities. The social fabric of our nation continues to be shredded by polarized opinions on many divisive issues. Add to that the despair that plagues so many of our individuals as evidenced by our current epidemics of substance abuse and broken relationships. Our hope for healing what ails us is that balm of Gilead that makes the wounded whole, as suffering slaves of the 19th century America sang. Peter reminds us, as he did first century Christians, that our only hope for healing lies in our once wounded and now resurrected Lord, who heals us and leads us into a new way of life according to his example. Interestingly, today's scripture begins with acknowledgement towards painful suffering, but ends with a pastoral depiction of a guardian shepherd. For us, that combination is a powerful reminder that no matter what we experience, as we hold fast to our faith in Jesus Christ and risk our lives for what is right, we are always brought back into the fold and guarded by the grace of that good shepherd. We were never promised an easy journey, but our good news is that Christ is present with us. We can count on Jesus to stand by our side and journey with us, not just during the good times, but also in bad. Jesus also calls us to journey together as a community and work for God's vision of justice and righteousness so that it becomes a reality for all creation. Let us pray. Shepherding God, in a dangerous world, let us hear your voice and come and go through your gate. We pray for the whole world, that we may be devoted to your word and to universal fellowship, being generous to all who have need. We pray for the earth, for green pastures and still waters, that we may restore them to the goodness and purity that they had at the time you created them. We pray for the people of the world, their nations and leaders, that your wisdom and peace may govern all, so that no one will fear. We pray for all those in need, for those in want, those ill, and those dying, that we may be the banquet that you set before them, as we anoint them, feed them, and comfort them in your name. We pray for ourselves, our families, and those we love. May no one live in fear. May all dwell in your presence. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Mindful of what all Christ has done for us, we give of ourselves and our gifts. Will the usher please come? Holy God, we ask that you take these gifts we give back to you for the building of your kingdom. Amen.
Thank you.
tithes and offerings, that they may become green pastures and still waters for any and all who need your comfort and restoration. Amen.
Please remain standing as we sing the closing hymn number 381, Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us.
Community to all who come through our doors. May we be a light in these dark times. And God, I ask you to bless our fellowship this afternoon. Bless our food, the hands who have prepared it, and the conversations around tables. May this time together to continue to build our relationships with one another and create a community loved by you. Amen. I'm going to go to the hospital.
Thank you.